our choices that we make, not our intentions, not our desires, not our hopes and our dreams, but our choices. Our choices is what directs us along the path, what we do, the actions we take. And have you ever had one of those times in your life where you should have seen something coming? Or maybe you did see something coming, but you ignored it? Come on now. Yeah. You should have seen it coming, you ignored it, maybe you had a sense that the choices you were going to make were going to end badly for you, but you made the choices anyway. It's easy to think that the bad things that we face in life won't happen to us. In fact, that's the basic principle of your teenage years, right? Is that bad things won't happen to me. I'm invincible. Nothing bad can happen to me. How many of you have ever had stitches when you were a teenager just because of that choice? Yeah. Nothing bad can happen to me. It's nothing. You know, I thought that as a dad early on. I've got two boys, okay? My oldest son is 4, my youngest is 2. And I remember being a young dad and thinking, you know, everybody always tells me, like, I need to cover him up when I'm changing his diaper. I mean, I really don't need to do that. That's stuff for movies, right? I mean, he's not actually going to baptize me right now. Oh, wait a second. Nope, that's not right, is it? No. Yep, you learn. If you've got boys, you know. In fact, I learned this lesson way too much growing up. In fact, as I thought about this message today, too many stories came to mind about times when I should have known better or I saw the danger ahead. I have way too many stories for that than I should. I'm lucky to be alive, honestly. Amen. Yeah. So I'll tell you just one today. So something you should know about me as a kid, I was a part of a program that was great called Royal Rangers, okay? For those of you that didn't grow up in the Assemblies of God culture, Royal Rangers is sort of like Boy Scouts for Jesus, okay? And so it's great. I mean, you go camping, you tie knots, you do things with knives. I mean, it's an 8-year-old boy's dream come true when you think about it. One of the things they teach you in Royal Rangers, which the jury's still out on the wisdom here, but they teach you how to start a fire with one match. Now see, you're already in those modes where you see danger and you feel like we should turn. So I loved starting fires. I could do it better than anybody. I mean, they had this competition where you'd light a fire and you have a string along the top. You get one match and you get only so much and you have to burn the string. And so I loved that stuff. Okay, I still to this day, I can still start a fire with one match. I can still do it because I just love starting fires. And so enter my childhood for a moment with me. And I really blame Royal Rangers for this. They taught me how to do this. And so, anyhow, I love building fires. And I burned a lot of things. In fact, everything that I could. There were little spots around my parents' house. I lived in a little neighborhood. There were little spots where I had dug out these little fire pits where I would set little fires. And I mean, all sorts of stuff. And if you're a kid in here today, please, please don't listen to what I'm doing, telling you, because what I'm about to tell you is dangerous, all right? So I had set fires to so many different things. I wonder how that burns. And so I was probably about 12 years old at this point, and I burned about everything I knew how, but there was something that I had heard was really flammable that I had never set fire to, and so it became the object of my day, that day, to do that. So, because I'm concerned about safety, and really the fear that my parents would find out, I created a brilliant scenario. You see, I grew up in Oklahoma. If you know anything about Oklahoma, it's hot, it's dry, and so it's really, really not safe a lot of times to start fires outside, okay? And so I thought, I'm going to do the safe thing. I'm not going to start this thing outside. I'm going to do it inside, because that's safer. So I cleared the garage floor, concrete garage floor, and I grabbed this new fuel. I wanted to see how isopropyl alcohol burned. See, you see the danger, Okay? You see it. So I do my thing. I clear it all out. I'm ready. I pour a little bit onto the concrete, light the match. Nothing happens. Well, that's disappointing. So what do you do as a guy, right? All the guys in this room are going to resonate with this. What do you do? If a little bit is not enough, more is probably better. Amen. Amen, right? So, bottle of alcohol. Now we're shaking it out. All over the garage floor, right? All over the garage floor. Light another match. Toss it. Man, it didn't work. Now, there is something you need to know. I'm not a chemist, okay? But I learned something that day about chemistry, all right? Different things burn different ways, okay? So for instance, I remember all the way back to my 10th grade chemistry class, and the chemists in the room can correct me on this. Copper, when it's on fire, burns green. Do you know that? Burns green. Different things burn different ways. Alcohol, when it's on fire, burns a very, very light blue. So light that you can barely tell that it's actually on fire. Until I did one of these and I caught the light just right and I realized the entire garage floor is on fire. Should have seen it coming, huh? Now, thankfully, before you fret too much, no firemen were called. You know, this is not a story that ends in, and they were able to put out the fire. No, it didn't know. That's not how this, we were able to get it out quickly, my brother and I frantically, and nothing was damaged. But nevertheless, we face situations and have faced situations. Judging by the laughs in the room, you have done something just as stupid as me, okay? We've all had those moments where we saw danger, and it wasn't like all of a sudden it just happened for me. There was a progression that took place. There was a path that I was walking on. When that turn didn't work, what we do? We take another step. We take another turn. And before we know it, we're in a situation. And we're sitting there going, how did I end up here? You end up there, right? Because of a series of choices. The principle of the path we talked about last week. That our direction, not our intention, determines our destination. The choices we make will determine the outcomes, many times, of our situations. That the choices that we make. This is a challenging thing. As we hear this story, we think of the stories in our own life, I'm reminded of a very particular verse of Scripture. This comes from Proverbs chapter 22 and verse 3. This is where we're going to land this morning. You can write that verse down and maybe on the backside of your bulletin or whatever, because this is really important this morning. This is going to be the driving force. In fact, if you were to memorize a verse of Scripture, this would be a good one to memorize. A good one to memorize. It says this: a prudent person foresees danger and takes precaution. A wise person sees danger and takes precaution. The simpleton, let me stop there. When the Proverbs uses simpleton, it means fool. It means the simple one. Other translations will say the stupid one. How many of you want to be stupid? Basically, no hands, okay? Nobody wants that. The wise one. You know who's wise? God. The one who aligns with God. Foresees danger and takes precautions. But the simpleton, the stupid one, the fool, goes on blindly and suffers the consequence. The prudent person foresees danger and takes precautions. The simpleton goes on blindly and suffers the consequences. And we've all had those situations where we saw the danger. Well, we knew that relationship wasn't good for us. We knew that financial choice wasn't good for us. We knew that that decision right there, the words that I'm about to say, are not going to be good. But we continued on. We continued on. And we suffered the consequences. And maybe we continue on because we fool ourselves into thinking, that won't happen to me. If I make that choice, I mean, really. I mean, a few years ago, we learned this the hard way as a nation. We had about 2008. You remember there was a massive fallout in the economy, one of the worst since the Great Depression. It was all built on mortgages that were over-leveraged, given to people that were over-leveraged. They say, I could never lose my house. And then we saw literally by the tens and thousands people losing their homes because they didn't foresee that, I'll be able to pay for the interest when it gets adjusted, and all of a sudden they can't, right? The fool goes on, suffers the consequences. We take it step by step because it's easy for us to think in terms of today. It's easy for us to think in terms of right now, this immediate situation in front of us. But the prudent, the wise, the godly see danger and they do something. But the simple, they see the danger and they say, well, it'll probably just work out. It's just somehow going to get better from here. If you're loaded with consumer debt, you know it didn't happen overnight, right? You know it was a series of situations. You know it was a series of choices that led to the pressure that you feel right now every single day. It's a series of choices. It's easy to think I can manage it. I mean, it's 12 months, same as cash, right? Those are some of those dangerous words in American English language. 12 months, same as cash. Oh, I mean, I'll pay it off in 12 months, and then all of a sudden the car breaks down and you don't have the resources, right? The prudent see danger. We put ourselves in a situation where we know there's danger. We know at the end of the road is something negative and something painful, but we deceive ourselves. If you're married and you find yourself spending more and more time with someone who's not your husband or your wife, you have to realize that there's momentum, there's movement in that relationship. You're on a path. It's not just lunch. It's not just flirting. You're on a path that leads somewhere, somewhere very dangerous. If you have to find yourself, if you're in a situation where you have to lie to get a certain outcome, you have to tell untruth, you have to fill a form a certain way, or you have to tell the IRS that maybe you didn't make as much money as you actually made. I mean, the reality is you're going to use it for good things, right? So it's okay. I mean, I don't mean to do it. I'm not a bad person. If you're lying to get your outcome, you've gone the wrong way. You're on a path that's going to lead to a place. I mean, it's easy. I'm on IRS. I'm on that form. Oh, I can not include that one thing here. No big deal. They're not even going to miss the money. In fact, they're taking too much of my money anyway. I say that every year at tax time. They're taking way too much of my money. Way too much. We're on a path. I'll never get audited. I mean, there's like, you know, 300 million Americans, how am I ever going to get audited? You're on a path. You're on a path that you know, leads somewhere. No one has to tell you. King Solomon would respond today, man, that's foolish. It's a bad choice. You're not wise. You're moving in a direction that you know you're the path you're on. See, the danger of trading tomorrow for today is that one day down the road, when all these choices add up, you're going to wake up. And I don't mean to be the guy that's like super climactic, but this is just true. I've seen too many people weeping in my office because of choices to know this is true. That someday down the road, you will wake up with fewer choices and all of them are going to be very poor. All of them. Because you'll continue on a path. On a path. This is not always sin-related. We talked about a few items that were like that. We face forks in the road all the time. We talked about it last week, how we face times when we just have to make a decision and we have to determine where God would lead us, what path God would put us on, or the path that would lead to pain, or path that lead to frustration. And so we face these forks in the road. We have to choose the path that God wants us along. And as we're going, I don't know if you've ever had this happen to you, where you're getting ready to make a choice, and all of a sudden the alarm bells start ringing loudly in your ear, like, don't do this. This is not a wise decision. My dad, the way he would put it probably, is that whole lost in space, danger, 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 Robin. Right? That's what my dad would say. We have those moments where the alarm bells are going off, and when we're in those moments, we gotta stop. Please. You gotta stop. Before you make that choice, before you say that word, before you sign that thing, stop. Stop. Because you're on a path. Now, some of you might be here today and you're thinking, wait a second. Whoa. I have already made the decision that I have the alarm bells about. How do I get off this train? How do I get where I need to be? What does it take to avoid this path to begin with? And I think there are four things we're going to highlight this morning. Four things, four words that you can write down that will save you, I promise, will save you great frustration and hurt and calamity. But before we talk about them, I really feel the need to reiterate why we should talk about them. Because sometimes, I've been in the church for a long time, my whole life, okay? Because sometimes we sit in church and we think, this is a great message for that person who is sitting in that other section, right? This is a great message, especially as we talk about choices. This is a great message for the teenagers that are in the room, or college kids. They're at the beginning of the journey. This is a great message for them. They should really be paying attention to this. We think that, but it's really important for all of us. It's important for two reasons. First of all, if you're sitting here today, and I want to specifically talk to those who follow Jesus for a little bit, because this is where you're most vulnerable to this. If you're sitting here today and you think you're insulated because you're smarter and wiser or more godly or older, you should really tread with caution. Because the Bible says that pride goes before the fall and a haughty spirit before destruction. And so if you're here today and you think, oh, I've been through this before, I got this figured out. Whoa, my goodness, you're on a dangerous path. The pride goes before the fall. Basically, you're headed toward a path of pain. And second is this. It's important to recognize that we walk a journey that is not only full of choices, but full of traps. Isn't that true? The Bible says we have an enemy. The same way that we have God, we have Christ who loves us, we have an enemy who hates us. The Bible says, Peter, the Apostle Peter says that he's like a lion seeking whom he may devour. Jesus said that he's one who comes to steal, kill, and destroy, that he's a liar, that there's an enemy who's setting traps for you. And so no matter how wise you think you are, maybe even no matter how wise you really are, there's an enemy who's actually trying to sabotage your life. And it's because of it, this is really critical stuff. That the choices we make, the paths we get on, the journey we walk down has to be based on what God has for us. So four words I want you to write down. We're going to talk about, I'm going to move through them quickly, and then I'm going to provide some context. The first word is action. Action. You have to do something. You have to end that relationship. You have to make that phone call. You have to come clean. You have to get rid of your computer in your home. Maybe get rid of your DSL. You have to downsize. You have to have that hard conversation. You have to get the new job. You have to do whatever it takes. And if you're in a situation where you're headed down the wrong path, it is not good enough to just go, oh, it's going to be okay. I've sat with couples. I'm telling you, tears down their face. Don't know what to do. If we look at their budget, they're overextended. And I go, well, you got to have a car, right? So we got to have to figure out how you can pay that car payment because you got to have a car to get to work. What if you cut cable out of your life? Oh, I can't do that. I mean, I watch that one show on Thursday night. And I sit there going, what in the world? You have to act. And all of us go, no brainer, right? But somehow we get in those situations. And we got to do that thing. And that thing is hard. That thing is really hard. We have to say no. Or we have to say yes. We have to have that conversation. We have to do that thing that will cause tons of inconvenience. But because we want to end in a good place, we've got to do it. And it's really hard. Because it really never really is about knowing what to do. You know how many times I've really not known what to do in my life? Very few. Most of the time, I know. In fact, when I'm counseling people, most of the time when I say, what do you think you should do to create a different outcome? They give the right answer. Most of the time, I have the right answer. What don't I have? The courage to do the right thing. Which means, it's not just about action. It's the second word you can write down. It's about sacrifice. sacrifice. If you want to move on the right path toward God, whether it's avoiding pain altogether or whether you're in the middle of that journey a little bit, it's going to require that you sacrifice. You may have to sacrifice relationally. You may have to sacrifice your outward reputation. You may have to lose a friend. You may have to sacrifice some money. You may have to sacrifice some lifestyle. You may have to be willing to lose something today so you can gain something tomorrow. You have to sacrifice. And I don't know what it would be, but the prudent see danger and they act. And that action almost always requires sacrifice. And that's why we don't do it. And see, you and I are tempted. I'm tempted. You hear the sermon one time. I get to hear it all week, okay? And the temptation is this. We get into our cars today and we go, yep, you know, he's right. This is true. He's probably right, you know. But boy, it's sure complicated. In fact, it's probably too complicated. I mean, how am I going to explain to him or her that I went to church today and I heard this sermon and now I know I need to act. I know this affects you. But I know that it's what the Bible would lead me to do. I know that it's the wise choice. I know that it's the godly choice. But Josh, that's great. I mean, that makes sense, but it's just too hard. It's just too complicated. I'm just going to keep on going. It's going to take action. It's going to take sacrifice. But here's a third thing that you may not be prepared for. The third word is embarrassment. This is potentially an embarrassing thing to do. That when we're on a path that we shouldn't be on, we're down the ways a little bit, and we're invested a little bit, and people aren't going to understand exactly what's going on. Sometimes, to get where we want to go, we have to be willing to be a little bit embarrassed. We have to be willing to let people talk about us a little bit so that in the end, we end up in the right spot. See, sometimes we're faced with choices. I thought of so many, and some of them are so deep and so personal that I can't share them from a pulpit because there's too many people involved over the course of ministry years. But I can remember times when I took a hit. I was embarrassed. I did something I knew was right. I avoided pain. I looked down the road and said, this is going to lead to hurt. This is going to lead to frustration. So I'm going to do the thing that may damage my reputation today, may embarrass me today, but later down the road, I'm going to look back and know it was the right choice. See, we try to avoid embarrassment. I hate to tell you, it's unavoidable. It's unavoidable. It's not only about sacrifice, it's also about potentially being embarrassed, even in good choices. So this means that when you're making decisions for your life and your marriage and how you're going to parent, how you do your finances, people roll in your house and say, why haven't you picked up that thing yet? Well, so we're going to do it a different way. We're going to say no to some things that we love, to say yes to some things we love even more. The final thing is this, final word is relief. Relief. Because once you've taken action, and once you've endured the sacrifice and endured the embarrassment, I can promise you this, it might be a year from now, it might be 5 years from now, it might be 10 years from now, but you will look back at this moment. In fact, many of you, some of you may today be making choices that you will look back 10 years from now and you're going to say, I am so glad. I'm so glad that I made a decision to act. Because I can guarantee you that it's way better to take on temporary hurt than to suffer destruction at the end of the path. You're going to think, what if I hadn't made that financial decision? What if I hadn't acted? And you'll breathe the sigh of relief. Action, sacrifice, embarrassment, or relief. Or, it's much easier to keep going. It's easier. I'm not giving you the easy way out today, by the way. It's much easier. Just keep on going. And one day, suffer harm. So I had this really cool opportunity when I was a teenager. I was about 17 years old. I had auditioned for this choir, and I got in. And it was this national thing. It was really cool. And I got to go to Europe as a 17-year-old kid. I kick myself now because, you know, when you're 17, you just don't know what you're getting into and how awesome it is, and you don't know what to pay attention to. And I look back and go, man, I wish I would be where I'm at now, going back, because I'd take in so much more. But it was still a wonderful trip. I got to go to 7 different countries and all sorts of stuff. It was fantastic. And I grew up in Oklahoma, so no mountains in Oklahoma. So we went to Austria, to Innsbruck. And if you know anything about Innsbruck, they held Winter Olympics there. And beautiful, beautiful place. The Alps that go through. I mean, I've never seen a mountain before in my life. And I'm looking at some of those beautiful sights I've ever seen. So we were planning on taking this trip up on a cable car up the mountain and going to the top. And so there were 4 stops along the way. And so we went 1, 2, 3. And I had listened to a guy who's from Montana. I didn't know him. He was my roommate for that part of the trip. And so I said, hey, you think it's going to be cold up there? I mean, I've never been on a mountain. I don't know. He's like, oh, you'll be fine. Dude's from Montana, you know, so he's got thick skin and he doesn't need a coat or something. I don't know. And so I'm wearing shorts, okay? I roll up on the mountain. I get 1, 2, 3. It's kind of cold up here, right? And so the third stop, me and a couple of my friends that I met on the trip decided, you know what would be great? It doesn't look that far off. Gosh, I have too many of these stories, okay? It doesn't look that far off. We'll jump off here. There's a stop there. We'll jump off here, and we'll just hike the rest of the way up. No big deal. Yeah. So that's why I said there's just too many of these. I know from experience. So we do that. We get about... First of all, it's a lot farther than you think it is. And second of all, it was cold. It was cold. And as we're going up, we got probably a couple hundred yards up this mountain, and it starts like raining and icy rain, like this. I'm freezing to death. And we're like, this is not fun anymore. Let's go back. Now, what was easy to climb was not easy to go back down. And so it was really loose. And it was fairly steep. And so what started as a walk moved into the jog, and moved into not a very graceful, but like flailing kind of run, you know? And I looked up, trying to get presence of mind, like, how am I going to slow down? And I look up, and there's this massive drop-off, this ravine. I mean, it probably went down 30, 40, 50 feet. It's probably another couple hundred feet away from me. This just got real. And I had to make a choice. Either I keep going the way I am, or I got to stop. But stopping, it's not like I could slow down, right? So I had one choice. My choices were limited. I could fall backwards and allow my body the friction against the ground to slow me down. Or I could die. So, given the poor choice options that I had, I fell backwards. And I slid probably 20, 30 feet. I was able to walk down the rest of the way. And I'm muddy. I'm bleeding. I'm hurting. I'm soaked. But I was alive. Because I was on a path. On a path that had a series of choices on it, that as I went, my choices, my good choices, were more limited and more limited and more limited. And so I had to take action. I had to take action. I knew that this action was going to require sacrifice. I knew as I'm walking, I felt the embarrassment as I got on that cable car with all of my other friends, like, what happened to you? But I can tell you that night, so I got back into my hotel, there was a sigh of relief. It was a sigh of relief. But I know I'd made the right choice. No matter how painful it was, no matter how in that moment it hurt, I was on a path that was leading toward pain. And I did not want to go there. So I had to make the hard decision to take action, to suffer some embarrassment, to make a sacrifice so that I could breathe that sigh of relief. Side story on that. That was in the days of calling cards, of those international cards. You didn't make phone calls internationally, didn't have email or any of that stuff. So I only had so many minutes left. In fact, I was running out of minutes, and I got to my next stop in Paris, and I called my mom. She said, "How's it going?" I said, "Oh, great. I'm having so much fun. I almost died the other day on the Alps." literally, it was like a two-minute conversation. "Oh, my time's running out. Gotta go. Bye." Click. 17-year-old kid by himself, you know, like 3,000 miles away from home. My mom's like, "What is wrong with you?" You know. Takes action. You know, this week I saw this play out in three different people in my life. Quick story, and then, in fact, can you come, Rod? Begin to play softly behind me. Three friends of mine, pastors, all faced with the same scenario. All of them were tempted with a relationship with someone who wasn't their wife. Okay? Which happens a lot in ministry. You see the stories, and the pitfalls are all there. All of that stuff. All three of them. Three great friends of mine. Great friends of mine. First one, who's very dear to me. In fact, he's the reason why we're in Ohio. Made a choice, and now is at a place in his life where he's suffering the full weight of his destruction. His wife has divorced him. He doesn't see what he's done as wrong. An affair. She's totally blind. I grieved. The next friend, this guy is honestly the reason, one of the reasons I'm here. Why I'm at New Life, why I chose the path of lead pastor. Walked down a path, ignored the warning signals, but didn't go far enough. He ended up having a text message relationship with someone who wasn't his wife, and they said things that you're only supposed to say to your wife. There wasn't nothing sexual, but he went too far. He went down the road too far, but he chose a different way. He knew that what he had done was wrong. And so because of that, he admitted it. He admitted it to our leadership and our fellowship. He's lost his church. But he's on a path that's going to lead him to restoration. He made a very, 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 very hard but very good choice. I'm on a path. If I keep going down here, I'm going to destroy my life. And so I've got to do the hard thing. I've got to jump off this path. And he did. And now he's on a good place. But it took a lot of sacrifice. Final one was a great friend of mine, pastors here in Ohio. A woman made an advance to him, on him. But here's the difference between all these other stories. It's a difference. You see, number one didn't have any safeguards, didn't listen to any bells, and he didn't even stop when it was, like, in process. He knew what he was doing was wrong. No one had to tell him. Listen, even if you don't love Jesus, no one has to tell you that having an affair on your spouse is wrong, right? If it wasn't wrong, then your wife wouldn't get mad about it. Okay? You don't have to tell him. He knows, but he's suffering destruction right now. He's away from the Lord now. Middle guy, he made some choices, and along the way, he ignored some of those bells, but then he finally came and said, "You know what? I gotta stop." But my final friend here, and it was amazing, all this happened in this week. My final friend, you know what? He had already made choices and already made sacrifices. And already put up barriers and guardrails and all these things so that when this happened, it never went anywhere. In fact, all the defense systems kicked in. And he was insulated from pain. You know what he said to me? I was talking to him about it this week at dinner with him. He said, "You know what?" He said, "The reason why I did all of that," and it's been hard for him, but believe me, that person's causing a big problem and all these things, but still, he's come out where his wife loves him, his church is behind him, all these things. He's coming out clean. because he put in safeguards and because he recognized danger. You know what he said to me? He says, you know what? I'm a red-blooded man, which means that I know I'm capable of having an affair on my wife because I know I have hormones and I know I have all these things. And so you know what I'm going to do before it even all starts, before any emotions get engaged, before, I'm going to create safeguards that create havoc, it creates scheduling problems, it creates all these things. I mean, having meetings, you know, with female leaders, but I've got to have another person, I've got to have all, it creates a lot of scheduling stuff. But he's not crying today because he saw danger. He saw pain. He says, I'm taking precautions. I'm getting off this path. Maybe you're here today and you're on a path. You're on it. You're like, you're 25, 30, 40% in there and you see the danger. And today, you have a very important decision to make. I'm not saying easy decision. I'm saying important decision. You need to take action. You know what you need to do. And if you don't, I'm happy to help. You need to take action. It's in your finances, in your marriage, in your parenting. Maybe it's with the internet, maybe it's with pornography. I don't know what it is. But you need to take action because the path that you're on, you know where it leads. And you're foolish to think that you won't be affected by it. I'm going to ask you to close your eyes and bow your heads this morning as we close. Again, this is one of those moments between you and Jesus. No one looking around. You know, this is, we want safety to be present in this room, that people can respond to what God's doing. If you're on a path that leads to destruction, maybe you're at the mouth of the trailhead. You know, you can see it far off and you're thinking about this decision. Maybe you're not even on it yet. But you want to get off of that path. Would you be bold enough to take action this morning in a very simple way? With everybody's heads bowed and eyes closed, would you be willing to stick your hand in the air and back down? Say, I'm on a path and I want to get off. And today my action is to start here today in this service. Thank you so much. Put it right back down. Thank you. Anyone else here today? Be so bold and so brave. I know it's hard, but you've got to go there, man. You got to do it. Anyone else here today would want to take action? I want to pray for you. And then we're going to sing a song together. There's power in the name of Jesus. You may not, maybe in a spot today, before I pray, I'm going to say this because we're going to sing this song and it's so appropriate. You don't know how you're going to do it. It feels way too big. Well, guess what? You're never going to do it alone because Jesus is with you and there's power in the relationship you have with Jesus to break the chains that are on your life. So I want to pray for you. We're going to have Rod leading this song. Let's pray. Father, there's been a few that raised their hand today, honestly, and I'm so proud that they chose today to take action. That's hard to do. It means sacrifice, it means embarrassment, but it also means relief. And so, Father, I would pray today, Lord, that you would not only give them the wisdom to know what to do, but the courage to do it. That maybe before they even leave this room, they're going to talk to somebody. They're going to involve some people so that they can have the greatest possibility of success. They're going to make that phone call. They're going to break that relationship. They're going to do that thing they need to do. They're going to take action. They're going to take action. They're going to do something. They're going to do the wise thing, the right thing. God, give them courage to do it today. And God, as we sing, may they feel empowered by the Holy Spirit, knowing that you're not going to leave them alone. But you're going to help them. In Jesus' name.